4:13, we should start with our final session of the day. The title of the session is The Future Missions of Science and Exploration. My name is Chris Zuckney. I'm from Honeybee Robotics, and we have with us the co-chair Barbara Cohen from Marshall Space Flight Center. So the question, who is controlling the slides? Okay, thank you. So I'd like to introduce the first speaker, which is conveniently Barbara Cohen. The title of the presentation is Lunar Flashlight and Near-Earth Asteroid Scout, Exploration Science Using CubeSats. The presentation is 15 minutes, and we usually give a speaker 12 to 13 minutes, and then we have 2 minutes questions and answers. Barbara, over to you.
Thanks, everyone. I'm glad to be here. This was originally just about Lunar Flashlight, but Julie Castillo, who is the PI for NEA Scout, is not able to come, so I'm just going to quickly try and cover both of them at the same time. You heard about these last year if you were here. The thing that has changed since last year is we passed our MCR SRR and we're fully manifested, and we are going to be ready to fly in 2018. Someday we'll get an invited talk. So these are CubeSats that are on the Earth-Moon 1 first test flight of the Space Launch System, which is the full-up integrated stack of the brand new rocket that NASA's making, plus the Orion crew capsule on top. But there's no crew inside, and instead what there's going to be in the adapter ring between the crew capsule and the rocket stack is going to be 12 little places. One's going to be electronics. The other 11 will be 6U CubeSat dispensers. And so 3 have been selected and manifested already. There's another 2 coming down through Advanced Exploration Systems. And if you talk to PM Clark, she can tell you about Lunar Ice Cube, which is coming up. I think she has a talk on that tomorrow. And there will be others that will get added. Simplex, the call went out. That was one of the things that could take advantage of this opportunity. Low-cost access to space for heliophysics and astrophysics could take advantage of this. The CubeSat Challenge for students is also going to provide up to 4 if they are able to make it onto this. And then there's other customers as well. So right now, only 3 are manifested. The rest will be selected. The 3 that are manifested are through, like I said, Advanced Exploration Systems, which is the Human Exploration Division of Research, basically. And so these are things that we want to be able to research and develop to be able to send humans to these destinations in the future. So the 3 that are manifested, BioSentinel from NASA Ames, Lunar Flashlight and Near-Earth Asteroid Scout that I'll talk about. BioSentinel I'm not going to spend much time on. It's a really interesting experiment with microfluidics and genetically modified yeast, where the yeast cells themselves, when they experience a double-strand DNA break, change their response with the amino acid lysine. And so you can put them in a growth-specific medium. You can detect cells that have had a double-strand DNA break during their transit in space, and so you can determine the rate of double-strand DNA breaks using microfluidics. And Lunar Flashlight and Near-Earth Asteroid Scout are what we're going to talk about today. Let's whip through those. Near-Earth Asteroid Scout, you'll see both of these have a common bus, mostly a common architecture, using a 6U CubeSat and a really giant solar sail. It's 85 square meter solar sail. This is because the SLS will put us into cislunar space approximately. The profile of that SLS launch is that it's going to go in a figure eight around the moon. It doesn't go into lunar orbit, but it takes you out of Earth orbit as well. So it leaves you in space. You can use low ISP in-space propulsion methods, one of them being a giant solar sail. So Near-Earth Asteroid Scout is going to use its giant solar sail to propel itself to a near-Earth asteroid. It's a flyby mission. It doesn't slow down and rendezvous. It'll just fly past. But this is seen as a pathfinder to very low-cost characterization of potential human destinations. So if we want to send a human mission to a near-Earth asteroid and we don't know necessarily what it looks like beforehand or what the regolith is going to be or if it's a solid body, if it's a rubble pile, all these things, this is a good way to do a really cheap flyby, get some of these characteristics down so that you don't have to design for all cases with your human mission, which is going to be very expensive. So it's a nice to have that addresses strategic knowledge gaps. Lunar Flashlight, you can see our little flash here. This is the flashlight part where we're going to use that solar sail. It's very similar to Nea Scout that you saw. We use the solar sail to propel us into a low energy Earth, moon capture orbit. And then as we spiral down, we'll take low passes over the lunar south pole. And when we do that, instead of using our solar sail for propulsion, we'll turn it 45 degrees to the sun. We'll bounce the sun off of the solar sail and use it as a reflector and bounce that light into permanently shadowed regions on the moon. And then we'll use passive spectroscopy to look for signature of water ice, specifically in those lunar craters. So I'm going to talk about the measurements of both of these in a little bit more detail. For lunar flashlight, like I said, these are all out of human exploration, and so we don't use the decadal survey. We use the the strategic knowledge gaps. Those have been developed by the community as nice-to-haves for human exploration. This is the one that we're using for lunar flashlight. Understand the lunar resource potential. So this is something that's, of course, very interesting to science, but this is why we're doing it. It's for humans to exploit the composition, quantity, distribution, and form of water and H species in lunar cold traps. This is what we want to be able to do if we send first humans. They're not going to have a backhoe to access the deep water at the lunar poles. They're also not going to have, giant regolith mining techniques to be able to take the monolayers off that M-Cube saw. So we're looking for frost at the surface that would be easily exploitable. So what we're going to do is illuminate those permanently shadowed regions, detect water ice. That's our measurement goal, and then we're going to do that a bunch of times, and that's our mapping goal. There's some suggestions, of course, that lunar ice frost exists in permanently shadowed craters at the South Pole already, but it's not definitive. That's why we're going to go make this definitive measurement. If you're going to send humans to exploit it, you want something more definitive. Diviner, of course, has measured the temperatures on the moon, and some of these permanently shadowed regions, it can get very, very cold. In those regions where it does get very cold, these kinds of places appear, they correlate with increased albedo by one of the LOA lasers, the one at 1064 nanometers. So one of the LOA laser wavelengths has an anomalously bright return at that wavelength. And so that could be something that, well, it is consistent with water ice frost. It's also consistent with something other brightening the soil, some kind of roughness effect, or who knows, there's never any solar wind getting in there. There could be some kind of regolith issue going on. So it's not definitive, but if you did say it was water ice, it's consistent with sort of a few weight percent. So not very much, but still there. And Paul Hain, the project scientist, has done some work on LAMP as well. So LAMP, of course, is the UV instrument. And in some of these craters, you can see not all of them, again, they're not all filled, these niches, but some of them have an anomalous albedo ratio in the UV, also consistent with brightening by water ice, but not totally definitive. So there's some suggestion that this could be water ice frost. None of us would be surprised to see it there, but we would need to make a definitive detection. So that's what we're going to try to do. This is how we do it. It's just standard infrared reflectance here, wavelengths and reflectance. And so we have a passive spectrometer because we have an active illumination source. It's actually a four light buckets, essentially, and it's going to be looking in the water ice overtone bands. Unfortunately, we can't look at the 3-micron band as much as we would like to, because with a 6U CubeSat, there's not really a lot of places to put a cryo cooler. So we can't cool enough to get to the 3-micron band, so we're looking at the 2 and the 1.5 overtones. And also, we aren't going to expect to get enough information to be able to place the spectrum and absolute reflectance. So we're going to do a ratio technique where we detect the band center, and then we detect in the continuum, and we do a band ratio, and we use that to detect the water ice. So here what I'm showing is down here is the lunar regolith, and up here is lunar water ice. This dark spectrum here is a half a weight percent. That's our measurement goal. That's sort of the lower limit of what we consider operationally useful. That's defined at a JSC and KSC with the ISRU people. So that's what they want to see, is half a weight percent or more water ice abundance. So that's our detection that we're trying to get. And then, like I said, we're going to do it a bunch of times. So we want to be able to, again, be operationally useful. If you want to send a rover, or you want to send humans, you want to know where it's different and where it's not different. where these things exist rather than just a big footprint over the entire pole of the moon. So we have about 60 orbits to do this. They're varying altitude, and of course the topography falls away in a varying way. So we have sort of an order of magnitude estimate of what we're expected to see in terms of footprint on the surface. We're aiming for 1 to 2 kilometers. Right now we think that 95% of our measurements will come in at 2 kilometers or better. I'm not going to hold us to that because it depends on a lot of things, but it's looking good for about 2 kilometers per footprint. And that should give us nice coverage over a lot of these areas. We'd like to get the Elcross site. We'd like to get Shoemaker Crater. We know these are of high interest to the community. I'm not in charge of the trajectory, and I'm not in charge of the launch date. So we are secondaries in a very true sense that we're just riding along. So when we get launched and we see what trajectory can get, then we'll know where we're going to be covered. Okay, near-Earth asteroid scout, again, looking at the strategic knowledge gaps for near-Earth asteroids, near-Earth objects. Near-Earth asteroid scout is getting at a lot of these. Lunar flashlight is very specific. NEA scout has a whole host of things that it wants to get, and it can get all of these with just a single flyby, so it's super interesting. I'm just going to whip through this, but if you want to see this, Julie has this, or you can come ask me, but it's a lot of things like the actual location, so you can actually go there. The size, the rotation rate, the particulate environment, the regolith, mass and density, surface morphology, all these things that you'd want to know. Their baseline target right now, 1991 VG, you've probably heard a lot about this. It's everyone's favorite target. It's easy to get to. It's got a diameter between sort of 5 and 10 kilometers. We're not 100% sure. And there'll be opportunities to observe it between now and then as well, so we'll get more information on it. The exact target is a function of launch date, so if we have to slip the launch date, we'll have to pick another target, and the flight time may change as well, but this is our nominal target. What it's going to get, lots of pictures. It's got a camera, and so it's going to be flying by the asteroid, so it's going to have an approach and a leaving phase, you know, just like we saw with Pluto, obviously, and so it's going to get higher and higher resolution images. So first it has to detect the target. It's going to have onboard detection to be able to find it and approach it, and it's going to have reconnaissance and close proximity imaging to address all these different SKGs. Here's what it looks like as it's coming in. You sort of get its size and rotation, then you'll get these close flybys. It'll come back out. Again, just a little camera. It's a tiny little, only a third of a U camera, but it's inherited from other programs, so we know it's robust and space ready and can fit on a CubeSat. They're also having color imaging with one of the strips of the CCDs having filters in place in front of it, so there'll be some limited color imaging as well. Here are our challenges fitting into S6U is very, very challenging. We have mass and volume constraints. The mass can't be more than about 11.5 kilograms. Really, we're limited by our volume. I'm just showing you a schematic just to see how we pack it all in there. And right now, it's very challenging. I can't even say that we have a design that closes. We're working on it. But fitting all of these things into a small space is definitely difficult, especially things like having a deep space transponder to be able to receive and send an X-band. So that's not a trivial thing. That's a new development. Solar sailing is our biggest challenge that we're facing right now. I wanted to show this because I've shown this before, but what I've added here is a mass-to-sail area comparison for things that have flown and for us. And so Planetary Society just launched this nice LightSail 1. You can see it didn't fully deploy, or it doesn't look like it fully deployed. We're still trying to analyze that. There was NanoSail D, which was a little tech demo. NanoSail D was about 1 kilogram per meter squared mass to bus, or mass to sail ratio. Icarus, which was a very, very successful JAXA mission, has a mass to area of 1.5. That's significant. That means that the spacecraft is controlling the sail. We are on really the wrong side of that equation. We are much less than 1, or 0.14 kilograms per square meter. And so we are having significant trouble with our sail pulling the satellite rather than the other way around. And so we are trying to close that technologically, but we're also pursuing other options like a chemical propulsion system and some kind of active illumination like a laser source. So we don't want to give this up yet. I'm still showing it. It's our baseline. But also don't be surprised if this changes just because solar sail with a CubeSat just may not be the thing to use. Okay, so to sum up, these are our three CubeSat missions that are currently manifested. They're getting cool science, of course, but they're really about addressing the exploration SKGs and maturing the future of CubeSats and hoping that we can use these again for these kinds of low-cost reconnaissance missions. Thanks.
Thanks very much. We have probably time for 1 to 2 questions. I've got one question. What's the life of a mission?
Yes, but it takes a while to get there. So the total lifetime is 2.5 years.
Hey, Barbara. Carl Hibbs, APL. Just a general question, since it's so challenging to get instruments into 6 years, where do you think NASA should put its technology development for miniaturization of instrumentation?
I haven't even had a beer, and you're asking me this. I think that it seems like going with chemical propulsion may be a much better solution. It seems like the measurements can be made. They're small bites, but they're significant bites. It seems like the solar sail we're having issues with, but having one decent instrument is not undoable on a 6U CubeSat once you get it to where you want it to be.
Great. Thank you. Thanks so much.
Thanks.
Thanks, Laura. Could we have